Does beef contribute to climate change? A lot of you messaged saying you were frustrated and confused with a video from a channel called What I've Learned, suggesting that beef is not that polluting, it's basically no big deal. So let's take a look at the controversy and see if we can make sense of this. Raising animals to eat causes greenhouse gas emissions. A big part of the problem is growing all of their food, which creates more emissions. That's not contested. Everybody knows it, and the video acknowledges it.
Of course, livestock have an environmental impact.
The question is the magnitude. Is this a big problem or is it minor? The video interviews a scientist who says eliminating all animal agriculture in the US would make a small difference. It would only reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 2.6%. And if only some people cut back, then it would be a tiny effect, basically meaningless. The video cites this study to back that up. It's published in a respected journal. I've published several studies in that journal, so I obviously don't have a problem with it. So let's look at what the study actually did. They ran a simulation where we stop raising animals to eat, but we keep growing all of their food. We keep growing tons and tons of corn, even though all the cows and pigs and chickens are gone. In fact, the free space left by the animals, we use it to grow more crops. But at the current proportions we use right now, with all the billions of animals. So, a lot more corn. And because we don't have the manure anymore, we have to synthesize fertilizer industrially to grow all of those crops, creating more emissions. So the conditions they chose to simulate in the study are that we are condemned to produce fertilizer industrially, to grow tons and tons of corn we don't need, to feed billions of animals that don't exist anymore. So what do we do with all those tons of corn that are left? Well, according to the conditions they chose for their simulation, we would eat it. So in their simulation, our diet would be 80% grains and mostly corn. And not a normal amount of food, a huge amount. An excess of dietary energy. Because we have all this leftover corn and no cows to eat it. And not surprisingly, they found that this diet was not nutritionally ideal, that it led to some potential deficiencies. And even in this outlandish scenario, where we just keep producing tons and tons of crops we don't need, they still found it was better for the environment. They saw a statistically significant reduction in emissions compared to the current system with all the animals. But they conclude the magnitude of the difference wasn't that impressive if we do it like that. Yeah, if we keep producing all of the animal food, even though all the animals are gone, yeah, the emissions are not going to come down as much. But no one is suggesting that as a solution. Now, maybe this sounds a bit too weird to be true. Maybe I'm presenting the study unfairly. How do you know you can trust me? Well, you don't need to. Several teams of scientists from different countries wrote to the editors of the journal expressing their concern about this study, and the journal published those letters. Here's one from European scientists, titled Causing Confusion in the Debate About the Transition Toward a More Plant-Based Diet. It explains that in the study, nutrient deficiencies may have arisen from the unbalanced diet assumed in the plant-based scenario, with grains being 80% of daily consumption. Here's another letter from the US, titled, Without Animals, Farmers Would Reduce Feed Crop Production. Yeah, farmers would stop growing food for cows if there weren't any cows around. The titles of the letters almost tell the whole story. The authors of the study unrealistically assume that without livestock, Americans would continue to grow animal feed and just incorporate it into human diets. Feed crops take up 75% of US cropland. Without livestock, all that land could be used to grow vegetables, biofuel crops, food for export, and provide critical habitat for native wildlife. By eliminating the need for animal feed, farmers could transition to a wider variety of grasses, grains, pulses, vegetables, and fruits that would be healthier for humans and the environment. Here's another letter by scientists from Harvard and Oxford called Feedlot Diet for Americans. And then they added, resulting from a misspecified optimization algorithm. Because that's what we nerds sound like when we throw shade. The way the authors did the study is particularly nonsensical, as exemplified by their plant-based scenario. An energy intake twice that of an average adult, at almost 5,000 calories a day. With about 3,000 calories a day coming from corn. That's 24 ears of corn every day per person. And a half. And out of the 5,000 calories of food, over 4,000 calories from grains every day. More diverse diets, including vegetables, fruits, nuts, and seeds, legumes, would be possible. However, unfortunately, all the results in the study were based on implausible scenarios and therefore cannot represent realistic examples. Now, the authors replied And they don't dispute the basic facts of the study, all those numbers. They basically said this is the scenario they wanted to test. If farmers did not change their crops and kept putting out corn, and that's all that people had, what would happen? That was their focus. They conclude, our study's approach differs drastically from others in this field. So yes, if we eliminate the animals but keep producing all of their food and synthesize fertilizers to grow that food and start eating 5,000 calories a day, over half of which from corn, then yeah, the reduction in emissions is not going to be huge, and health-wise, that's not going to be great. That's what the study tested. So this is the study they cite in the video to make this key point that it's not worth moderating animal agriculture. Don't even bother because the effect is too small. What the study didn't test is what everyone advocates for. Moderate animal agriculture, especially beef. Moderate the tons of corn in monoculture. That frees up land and water and uses less fertilizer and generates less emissions. And we grow some more fruits and vegetables and legumes. Is that doable? That's an important discussion we should be having as a society. But this study didn't test that. Now, it's okay to cite the study. It's not trash science. We don't just dismiss it. It's interesting data in a way. It's good to know what happens in that specific scenario, I guess. But if we're going to bring this up, we have to understand what the study actually did and be clear about it. Not just throw out numbers like sound bites without understanding them. That just confuses people and sets us all back. Okay, so what happens in more realistic conditions where we don't just keep growing the cow food for no reason? Is it worth it to moderate animal production? Has that been tested? It's been tested many times by different teams of scientists in different institutions from different countries. Here's one study out of Oxford. Moving from current diets to a diet that excludes animal products has transformative potential, reducing food's greenhouse gas emissions by almost 50%. And they point out something important. The US meat consumption is 3 times the global average. So for us Westerners, dietary change has potential for far greater effect, reducing food emissions by 60 to 70%. That makes total sense. Since we eat a lot more beef, if we in the West change our diet, that's going to affect the whole globe a lot more than if Namibians change their diet. That scenario without animal products would mean a 28% reduction in global greenhouse gas emissions. So emissions from food cut in half or more, and global emissions total down by 28%, almost a third. Not 2.6%, the number they found when we just keep growing all the cow food. Okay, but completely eliminating animal products is not realistic. What if we just moderate it? A 50% reduction in animal products could mean 20% less total emissions, especially if we avoid the products with the largest impact. These researchers explain, animal products generate the majority of food-related emissions, over 70% of agricultural emissions, and changes in meat consumption dominate the impacts on emissions. They compared the impact of moderating animal foods to other strategies, like wasting less food or technological improvements. Here are the results. Drastically reducing food waste cuts food emissions by 9%. New technology slightly more, and changing our diet, moderating animal foods, 56% less emissions from food. And all three strategies combined, a bit over 60% reduction. And they're not talking about something drastic like everybody going vegan tomorrow. They're looking at a flexitarian diet that moderates meat and favors fruit, vegetables, nuts, and legumes. So, kind of a Mediterranean pattern. Same recommendations as for health. We've covered that here in like 100 videos. Takes care of health, takes care of the planet. If doing that to save the planet is extreme and radical, then I don't know what to tell you. Okay, what's the actual impact of this in the grand scheme? Is it worth it? That's what we want to know. They explain greenhouse gas emissions cannot be sufficiently mitigated without dietary changes towards more plant-based diets. That's a far cry from, oh, don't bother, the effect is too small, don't even do anything. Different study, different scientists. Consuming less animal products, particularly beef, is an effective way of reducing dietary emissions. Different one. Eliminating animal agriculture would negate 56% of emissions. Okay, what if we just moderate them? Substantial reductions in land and emissions could be achieved by switching from cattle to pigs and chicken. They would still have substantially greater impact than plants, but less impactful than red meat. Why do they all keep harping on the red meat? Do all environmental scientists just hate beef? No, it's because when you look at the environmental impact, it's completely disproportionate. Here's the emissions for plant foods. The further to the right of the line, the bigger the emissions. Here's eggs, dairy, fish, chicken, pork, and then ruminants like beef. It's on a different league even from the other animal products. Ruminant meat, like beef or lamb, has environmental impacts 20 to 100 times those of plants. The other animal products are 2 to 25 times higher than plants. This trend holds whether foods are matched by protein content, by serving, or by mass. That's in large part because beef requires a lot more feed. For example, producing 1 pound of milk or eggs requires 2 to 3 pounds of plants. For poultry, it's 2 to 5. Pork, 3 to 9. But for beef, it's 24 to 49. So less cows means a lot less crops we gotta grow. So yeah, if your simulation just keeps growing all the cow feed anyway, that's gonna make a difference. Okay, what if we just feed cows grass? That's better, right? For the animal, probably. Unfortunately for the environment, it doesn't seem to solve the problem. This study found that grass-fed beef requires more water, more land, more fossil fuels, and a bigger carbon footprint than conventionally raised. That's in part because they grow slower, it's a more natural process, so the emissions they cause extend over time and the total ends up being a little higher. These scientists explain that although ruminants convert grass, including on land unsuitable for crops, into human edible protein, the environmental impact of this conversion is immense. So does that mean that all beef is exactly the same? No, there's big variation, with some producers causing a lot more emissions than others. So there is room for optimization, but even the cleanest beef was worse than most other animal foods and much worse than plant sources of protein like beans, for example. So dietary change, changing the proportion of foods we eat, can deliver environmental benefits not achievable by just tweaking the production process. So the solution probably will involve optimizing the production of beef as well as moderating it at societal scale. Okay, what about fossil fuels? Isn't that the real problem? Can't we just cut back on fossil fuels and leave our food alone because we like it? Can't we just do that? This study published last year looked at exactly that question. Reducing emissions from fossil fuels is essential, but even if fossil fuel emissions were immediately halted, current trends in food production would prevent the achievement of climate targets. Thus, major changes in how food is produced are needed. They explain that to meet climate goals, we have to make substantial changes to our food system as well as other sectors. Of course, this is all connected. They show that if we completely eliminate fossil fuels over the next couple decades, not moderate them, but bring them to zero, then we'll have a bit more leeway on the food changes. We'll still have to make some, but maybe less drastic. Realistically, in order to have a shot at solving the problem, we will have to make changes to transportation and energy. But it's not enough. Food production is a big chunk of emissions, so we need to moderate a little bit everywhere to have a shot at making a meaningful change. We can't play this game of just change those things over there and not the thing I like. It's not gonna work. There's lots of powerful interests and people who would like fossil fuels to not be reduced. But we gotta do it. We can't just keep pushing the blame over. Now, this does not mean that every single human is gonna have to completely overhaul their diet. Some people are not gonna be in a position to make huge changes for health reasons or whatever it may be. Other people are just not gonna do it. That's reality. Hopefully the rest of us can do a bit extra to cover for those who can't. So the goal is not to shame each other, it's not to browbeat, it's to look at the evidence and have this crucial conversation and work together to beat a common enemy without bending the facts in either direction, not exaggerate them for effect, and not minimize them for mental comfort either. I know it's tempting to say, let's not change anything, it doesn't matter, don't worry about it, let's just keep doing what we're doing. I know that's a much more pleasant message to hear. And I know that what I'm saying is boring, unpopular, ruining the party. I get all that. But stating the facts clearly is the only way forward. Are animals, and beef in particular, a significant source of emissions? Yes. Is moderating them going to help? Yes. Is it a silver bullet? Is it going to solve climate change by itself? No. We're going to need to make changes to other sectors as well. Now, with every video we put out, our real goal is not to throw facts at you or to fact check, it's to provide the tools so that you can go through this process yourself, so that you can see through confusion. You don't need us to fact check every little thing that pops up. So, when you look at a study, when you look at a set of data, you gotta make sure that you, number one, pay attention to what they actually did, the experimental design, what was actually tested, not just a headline or a flashy number. And number two, look at the context of the field, everything that's been done on that topic. We call that totality of evidence and see how that study fits into that context. If we fail to do either of those two, we risk getting really confused. Now, remarkably here, they managed to make both of those mistakes at the same time. So the result, inevitably, was colossal confusion. I mean, it couldn't have gone any other way. The video even goes as far as saying that this scientist researches ways to make animals less polluting. That's his job.
In fact, his job is to research ways to reduce livestock's environmental impact.
So reducing their impact by tweaking the production process, that's important, that's a career. But reducing their impact by raising a bit less cows, that's not worth it, because their impact is not that big to begin with, so don't even bother. I mean, this is raising cognitive dissonance to an Olympic sport. But I'm sure they mean well, I'm sure they believe what they say, so nothing personal. And the channel, I really don't blame them. I'm not familiar with the channel, to be honest with you, but they did a lot of things right. They had a scientist on for more expertise and more substance, they had citations on screen, and they were peer-reviewed studies, so they really tried. That's a lot more due diligence than your average YouTube channel. We gotta recognize the effort. And I really don't blame them. They got unlucky. The message of the video is the exact opposite of the available evidence. It happens. Not the end of the world. We learn, we adapt, we move forward. They touched on a couple other ideas, water and land use. We can make more videos if there's interest, but I hope this helps clarify things a bit, because this is a crucial issue, possibly the number one issue of our time. So let me know your thoughts. Take care. See you next time.